morning. This is the March 17th meeting of the Reuse Subcommittee of the Public Works Commission. And we are going to start by seeing if we have a quorum. Susan, do you think we do?
Yes, we do.
All right. And we need to approve the minutes from February 11th. Has everyone had a chance to go over them?
Yes.
Yeah? Roger, did you go over them?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Ro, have you had a chance to go over the minutes from last meeting? Or were you
yes.
Not here? Were you here last meeting?
Yes.
Okay. So if everyone has been over them, is there are there any comments, edits to be made? Peter?
No, just motion to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Yes, Susan.
I'm sorry I didn't interrupt. I was
okay, they are approved. The minutes are approved for February 11th. Susan?
It occurs to me that John Sass will not be here, and I'm wondering if there would be a volunteer who would be willing to take some notes for minutes.
I can try and accomplish that.
Oh, David, can we see? Is there another volunteer besides David who's leading the meeting that would be willing just to jot notes down?
I will jot some notes down.
Thank you.
I'm using a green.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Recenter report. Progress. Who's making the
Matt, can you
progress report?
Yeah, I can start. We're in good shape in terms of getting the space ready to open. Alan has done a tremendous job building a set of new shelves on the Western Mall. And also, we have new shelf capacity on the eastern wall. In general, we're adding a really significant amount of display space for household, smaller household things in the main area.
And odd supplies.
Yeah, and in the annex, we have really reorganized things, and we've brought in some of these big panels to use as flooring in there. And we've really made an effort to get stuff displayed so that you can actually see what's in there. All that is good. And I know Debbie's been working on the list of end users so that we can advise people if we can't take stuff, you know, what are other options for it.
Who takes what list?
There's still, you know, still some work that needs to be done. We still don't have the roof repair done yet, so that Susan, I think, will have some new information on that. We are hoping to get the parking area painted before we open, and you know, that hasn't been done yet. We're ordering scales as part of our new plan to weigh things that go out and weigh things that we throw away. So that's, again, Susan's report, and tents also for intake and outgoing areas. At this point in the main space, we really need to finish up a few projects and sweep it out and get it, you know, cleaned up, get the winter dust out of there, basically, and then set up whatever materials we want to put in there before we open. And right now, our plan is to set aside April 2nd as a day for training and encourage all volunteers that can make it out there to go out and get a refresher on past procedures, get an update on changes, and hopefully all get on the same page in terms of how things are going to work out there. Some of us are going to meet with the gatekeepers this coming Monday and talk about some of the green sticker issues and that kind of thing. Scheduling, you will want to talk to you a little bit about getting the scheduling apparatus up on the internet so people can begin to sign up. And we've talked a little bit about having some changes in that, like maybe having not just a designated supervisor, but also a designated intake person, since that requires some special training. Those are the things that come to mind. I'm sure other folks may have something to add to that.
But you're comfortable with the schedule of training on the 2nd, and does that mean an opening on the 9th?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
And the training is 9 to 11.
Yeah, I think we decided it would be 9 to 11. We're also trying to put together a little flyer that's just a short, simple set of reminders about how the recenter works to give out here at the transfer station and give out up there, and then post anywhere we think would be useful, just to remind people the basics of how it works. So,
okay, great. Anybody else?
I just wanted to add that we're also looking at some signs. We do need to get the parking lines done, and that's been a little frustrating. I will talk to Jim about that today. Unfortunately, yes.
I think Jim's got so much to do with the director, and I think we're capable of doing the part right ourselves. I have the paint.
Okay.
And we should just do it.
You have what? Did you can the spray paint or?
I have.
What kind of paint?
White paint.
And what?
Brush.
Okay. That's a proposal out on the. What do you guys think of that?
I think that's a good idea. I would just say, I would send an email to Jim saying, because we've waited so long and we're about to open, that David Shearer has volunteered to paint the lines. And so unless we hear from him, so that way we're sharing with him.
Sure.
David tried all last year to do this. We talked about it at CPW, so.
So what kind of, do you know what kind of paint it is? Is it latex?
It's latex.
Okay.
When would that happen?
And when do you think we could do it, David?
Given our schedule here, like, on a Wednesday, that's right. We do Wednesday.
Most likely.
Okay.
Do you need somebody to help you with that?
Sure.
Okay, well.
It's not complicated.
No, I know, but.
It'd be nice to have a string or something.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
And we'll need some brooms to sweep off the dirt.
Yeah.
Asphalt.
I would help you.
That's great, David.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, you're gonna write an email to Jim.
Yep.
And copy it to David so that he can get a response to that. And then you'll let Diana and I know when you're gonna be out there, and we can make the date. Help out. It might be more than one date.
Excellent. Chris could set the date.
David, because he's the one that's.
Well,
I'll be
happy too.
Yeah.
You say when, and whoever will show up will help you.
Yeah.
Right. I hope it's
excellent.
And some of us are going to be out there on Saturday. This coming Saturday for a little bit. So, and then Wednesdays and Saturdays it's open. So.
Great. So, I'm gonna start advertising April 2nd as an all call for volunteers. Anyone that's interested. So it's not just supervisors and intake people; it's everybody.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anybody, and you know, particularly targeted at people I think who have been coming on a regular basis last year to let them know. And because some of those people may eventually step up and be supervisors or intake people or whatever, so we really want them in on that conversation.
Maybe those people who have been there before could come for those cleanup days also, because it'd always be nice to have more hands to do the cleanup too. Like Elaine here and Sally, and I'm not Bonnie.
You mean on Wednesdays?
For example, those dates that are the March 19th and 26th cleanup days.
March 19th being 2 days from now.
Oh dear, well not that one maybe.
Okay, well, you know, I'm really going to be promoting the training day. That's really what we're trying to get people.
Right.
And if they respond to me, then mm-hmm. I will tell them about the March 26th date.
Okay.
Okay, budget. Susan, do you want to give just a prelude to why we're talking about the budget?
Yes, we were talking about, first, do we want to have fundraisers? Should we notify people that things might be put in a silent auction? Which led to the question, there was some question as to, was it fair? Was it right? Since everything's supposed to be free, and then then that backed up the question to what do we need the money for, and then that backed up to the question, well, what was our original budget and what did we anticipate our needs be? We do have some grant money that I have access to, so we just need to talk about what types of things we want to do and what we our original plan. So David had created something for the budget for our proposal, and I have copies of it here that I can pass out.
Sure.
How much do we have in our budget?
Well, we haven't really been using a budget much. Because most of our resources have either been donated or have come from the DPW, as it is the case with some of the advertising for our events. So while we have some money in our revolving fund, it really wasn't clear when it should come from our revolving fund and when it should come from the DPW, because a lot of our events, such as our pop-up events, are open to the public, and it's a DPW service in a way. I mean, so especially the rallies that we have, and I was hoping to have a conversation to that effect with Ned, and now that's been put on hold. And when his successor is in place, you know, we'll have that conversation. But there's a lot of ambiguity at that. I think that some things should come out of the revolving fund, but some things should really continue coming out of the DPW budget. So that conversation needs to be had. So it's been, our budget here has been a little amorphous.
Roger?
First, what are the three main revenue streams and the money we get at events, the DPW budget?
Donations at the Reese Center.
Okay, right.
Revenue streams for us?
Yeah, for this committee.
Support for the DPW, there's donations we get at the Reese Center,
right.
And donations that we get at our pop-up events, which are, at this point, is only the toy swap that we ask.
Right. What's the grant?
The grant is a Department of Environmental Protection Sustainable Materials Recovery Program grant. And it's technically a grant to DPW, so there, you know, it's not money for us, but they have a new portion of the grant, which has been lucrative for us, and the fact that we now have a swap shop at the transfer station opens up some more funding from that grant, because part of the grant asks what you're doing at your transfer stations, and the fact that we now have a swap shop and are now taking clean wood for reuse bumps up the amount of money that we're eligible for.
So most grants, you know, have very specific places you can use that money, and reporting that has to be done. Are we doing that?
Yes. The specific way, it has to address waste reduction issues, recycling issues, and there is a marketing piece that some of the purchases can fall under, which would be not necessarily, some advertising is okay. I anticipate that, I know that we can get a tent from the grant, and I anticipate that the scale won't be a problem at all. And the signage, some of the signage that we've been using, the plastic core signs that we use for our pop-up events that I do the Burmishade with. Those have been purchased from the grant. So we have some help. And I do just want to say that through Karen's initiation and this committee's work and our continuing work, that Northampton has established itself as kind of a leader in the reuse area. We have been running these pop-up events. I wrote up Karen had gotten the grant, I think, that you guys all know about, that had paid for the postcard and other things, that was able to get some things going. And I wrote up a case study as like a closure of that grant about reuse events, and that is it's been posted on the DEP website and the National Northeast Recycling Council has included it in a reuse event packet that they have. So we really have we've helped put Northampton on the map for waste stream reduction, and I just want to give you all kudos for that. And this grant is. So I think that as long as we can make a compelling argument for why we need something, that this grant would cover it if the funds are available.
Mm-hmm. Susan, can I just get a ballpark figure for what we're talking about annually? Just how much?
The grant, I think we got $5,000 last year.
Is the $10,000 going to be renewed?
We have $7,000 left, and rolled over to this year. And we'll be in budget talks with the CPW for July 1st coming up, and I'm not sure what's going to happen with that. I think a lot of things are on hold because we're waiting for this director.
And we're hoping that the roof is going to be paid for out of that. Mm-hmm.
Did you say CP?
Commission of Public Works.
Okay.
So $12,000 right now is what we're
doing. The grant from us, right. The grant is a grant to the DPW, not to us. So we have access to some funds. However, it is an annual grant. So there's going to be, for the foreseeable future, a steady input from that grant into the DPW coffers, of which I think that we have a compelling argument to spend some on.
Okay, so this budget that we did, Susan, do you remember when we composed this?
This was in 2013, I think,
Really?
Was it 2012?
3 years ago? I would have said 2 years ago, but...
It was fall, so
In any case, we did a projections on a 3-year budget, and the total expenditures, including the volunteer coordinator, that were projected were $13,000 for the first year, $6,700 for the second year, and $2,500 for the third year. I think the assumption was that the volunteer coordinator would need a lot of time in the first year getting people engaged, and that would lessen as time went on.
We also anticipated quite a bit of tipping fees, which we did not.
Well, $1,000 the first year.
Yeah.
And this was based upon the research that we had done with
other swap shops.
Swap shops, yes. Public Works departments that had experience with reuse centers. We felt that $1,000 to $2,000 is probably where we should be budgeting based upon what they had spent.
Right, which is 10 times.
Yeah. Well, a place like Durham, New Hampshire, I think it's a much larger...
Yeah.
Not only that, but they don't review what you said.
Uh-huh.
So our model of being a zero-waste swap shop is a little different, because we
So there's no gatekeeping.
There's no gatekeeping.
Bring whoever you want.
Costs just transfer it back to the city if people just dump it.
That's right.
But it's not in our function.
We had, separately, we had $7,000 of physical plant improvements budgeted for the first year, $3,000 the second year, and $1,000 for the third year, which probably isn't that far off, right?
Well, one question is, what do we consider the year? Do we consider all of the pre-work that went up into, are we talking calendar year or fiscal year? If we talk in like 2014, we spent a lot of money from January to our opening for concrete, for wood, you know, and some of it came from the DPW, but
yeah.
We did spend a lot.
But not $7,000.
But not $7,000.
Right.
No, $7,000 is what we have left.
I don't know. That's $3,000.
No, but in the we budgeted $7,000
for. We didn't spend anywhere near that in the materials.
That's right, and in part because we didn't. We also had volunteer labor,
and
so
we
this
reused
was,
a lot of the materials that we had.
Right. This was a. This was created to demonstrate that we had thought about all of the potential costs and what we expected. This was part of a business plan.
Yeah.
So we were
well, but it was a marketing plan because we wanted to prove that we could pull this off budgetarily without costing the city.
Absolutely.
So we had for supporter donations, we had 200 the first year, 300 the second year, 400 the third year. How did we do in supporter donations the first year? Is 200 about right in terms of the money we took in?
Yep.
And it's pretty good budgeting. These numbers are not far off at all. So more important than the numbers, though, are the areas for which we budgeted. So infrastructure, physical plan expenses, very important. But in this discussion about why we need a budget, why we need to raise money for the reuse center, we need to look at each of these line items. Because we have zeros next to them doesn't mean that that's how it should be going forward.
Well, electricity, for example, who pays for that? Is that
that's
city?
The city.
That's the city because it's a city property.
So, but it's still an expense. It's just not
hard. It's still an expense. However, it's not heated space. So it's really lights and they're fluorescent lights, which are fairly efficient. So it's really quite minimal.
Okay.
And we're open Saturday morning. So it's even more minimal.
The coffee maker.
And Wednesday.
Circular saw usually. Do we actually pay for electricity?
No.
Even indirectly,
so
it's a
benefit
of using.
We're using somebody else's meter.
Well,
basically.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Sure.
But if the city's looking at our cost to the city, then they're going to go, oh, yeah, we use some electricity.
They can put $50 on that line.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, this discussion is really about, okay, well, where do we want to spend money, or where do we need to spend money that is not addressed here?
There were, one of the things that we've talked about is having meeting expenses. It would be really nice to provide refreshments without having somebody to shell out for them. So this is something that I think when we had pizza, when we had our volunteer thank you meeting, Ned paid for that out of his own pocket. And all of us, either through donations from Berkshire Naturals or Diana bringing stuff, we all have contributed from our own resources, and it would be very nice on occasion. I'm not saying every time we're, go get sandwiches or something, but it would be nice to be able to go get a couple things of coffee and some bagels without feeling guilty about it. Another case in point is our events. Now that's not a recenter budget, and this is something perhaps that I will need to talk to with Ned's successor, but all of our pop-up events, when we have refreshments, it's something I usually pay for at my own pocket too. And I just don't think that's appropriate.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's
right.
this is a volunteer-run thing. It is an amazing thing. And $20 to $30, $20 to $40 to keep your volunteers happy and make sure that they're willing to return again next year to help out is a really worthwhile investment. So those are, that's one piece that I think is still a gap that needs to be addressed. Another would
yeah,
be
we do have a little bit in there.
Yeah, I know, but no, we haven't used it.
Okay.
And you're not sure what the source would be for it?
Well, part of the problem is that Ned had tried to get reimbursed or asked if it was reimbursable, and it's my understanding that he was told no, that to buy refreshments for a city meeting or a city event was not doable. So it's not something that I had a chance to pursue, and until we have somebody in Ned's place, you know, I don't want to make any waves by going directly to, you know, the mayor or whatever. I mean, I think it's a lobbying situation where we need to demonstrate the importance of this because of the value that our committee provides to the city through volunteer work. So it's a you know, it's a discussion that needs to be had but hasn't been had.
Well, you know, we're talking about very little money. And I'm just wondering if, in fact, we've been successful in taking in $200, I don't know how much money we've taken in, that would more than cover the cost that you're talking about.
Absolutely.
So why not
use
that cash?
But if the city does not allow it, if it's a protocol, city protocol, not to buy food for city meetings, we have to find some way to work around that. And
maybe we just don't have refreshments. If it's a city protocol.
Which is a good argument for why there could be another organization like Green Washington that wouldn't be subject to the press.
Yeah. Is it
it's just, I mean, I'm not willing to, you know, I'll take it out of my part-time municipal salary. You know, I just think it's really important when you have people working hard to give them some orange juice. Sorry.
Well, you know, there's also the possibility of bake sales, and that, like we have had. I totally agree with you about. I mean, I think it really does encourage. It's nice. It's nice to be nice to the volunteers.
It's necessary. It's
yes.
Not just nice.
Yes. So we have had bake sales where there was coffee and water and cookies and stuff like that. And so,
well, that's
stock
that
gap.
Yeah, that requires.
Listing them
with the group that's providing the bake sale,
right?
And sometimes they're not able or willing to do it, and that's a very different thing too, because that's really geared more towards the public that come to our events.
Yeah.
And while it makes it available to the volunteers, the point is the volunteers are volunteering their time.
Yeah. Right,
so they deserve a donut if they want a donut.
Yes.
So, in my opinion,
I'd like to hear more about what people would like to see money for the reuse center. That's really what we're here to figure out. Mac and then Debbie.
Okay, well, I have a little laundry list that I've said before in this context, but one thing is there may be certain specialized tools that we need at the reuse center, like a scale. You know, the scale maybe we can get from the grant, but there may be things we can't get from the grant.
And the grant may not always be there.
The grant may not be there. So there's equipment and tools, okay? Also, we can extend reuse/recycling through various other programs, like the Green Disc program, where we can collect things that aren't recyclable here, but ship them away, specifically things like CDs, DVDs, cassette tapes, VHS tapes. Those we can collect, but we have to send them away and pay to send them to a processor where they will be ground up and then used for some other purpose. So we can have bins out there, but either we have to pay to ship it or we have to ask a donation for people. Mm-hmm. So that's another possibility. You know, Susan's talking about how we're regarded as sort of on the forefront of reuse. I really think that, you know, when these regional conferences come up, we should be sending somebody to them. And we should help pay for that if possible, because you know, we may have stuff to contribute, and we may also learn stuff, and it's another way to feed volunteer enthusiasm about what we're doing. So I think that is a really important thing. And you know, there's also in the end the whole question of tipping fees, you know, which the city has underwritten our tipping fees, but if there's eventually a question about are we paying our way, and we have $100, we can say, here's $100, give us credit for a ton of tipping fees so we can throw away some stuff that that's not being taken at the reuse center without, you know, everybody getting all upset that we're taking money away or whatever. So anyway, those are
To kind of echo what you're saying, Mac, I think it's really important for people in the city to feel like the reuse center is almost an independently operated, financially independent operation. No one, I shouldn't say no one, but there's a different perspective on what we do if we can show that we can be financially independent than if we're costing the city money. I think it's hard to justify for a lot of people, if it's costing the city money. So the more that we can do to be financially independent, I think really strengthens our position as our functionality and our viability. Any other uses that people, Debbie, yes, sorry.
The postcards. The postcards are great. People love them. I'd love to see that come back again.
That's not a recenter thing necessarily.
Well, yes, it is.
It's more of a It's a reuse committee thing, more of a pop-up event.
Karen did. That's why.
Well, but that doesn't mean that we can't raise money for it, even if it's on the fringe of what our purview is. We can. That's value added for what we're doing for the city, if we can make that happen.
Yeah, I guess I thought that the pop-up events were. Since it's what we do too, that this was part of that discussion. This would fit in there.
Well, we straddle a couple, you know, we walk a couple of lines. One is the recenter and the other is recycling and reuse separately. Somebody else had Diana?
I just want to echo the volunteer coordinator bit. If we ever had that kind of money, it would be great to have somebody that could take that off of your plate.
It would be great.
Yep.
And I just want to second Debbie there, because we, $1,500 I think is what the postcard costs.
No, it costs a lot more than $1,500. It was several thousand dollars.
It's possible that we could do something like that with this grant, like for next year or something, you know, because this is possible. I just don't know if we can do it every year.
Anyway, that's the kind of thing to not have to go to meet very specific guidelines for what we can and cannot do, you know, that shouldn't be a question. We should just have a budget, so it's something that we can spend out of the stuff that we think is a good payback.
Mm-hmm. Roger?
Well, I might have mentioned this last time about the idea of having a real good working workbench that volunteers could come in and take things.
Mm.
You know, so you have someone come in on a Wednesday or Saturday morning and they would actually, you know, take that lamp that's not working and fix it. Be nice to have some kind of a budget line for some of the stuff they might need, wiring, screws,
so
things like that.
Repair cafe.
Yeah, on-site
equipment.
Yeah.
Okay.
And donuts.
Anything else? Okay. If you know, obviously we can always add to this list, but I'm just wondering what the dollar amounts are that people feel are necessary on an annual basis. Like if we were doing a projection for this season of the recenter, Roger, how much would we want to allot for a workbench and for other equipment for the repair?
Really, it probably is widely variable figure. It depends on how much stuff we have there now, what people are willing to bring in. You know,
and donate.
Donation.
We often say our preference is to have reused the stuff, so
Mm-hmm. Well, but the point is, Roger, you want to have money there if you need it.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right? That's so what kind of a rainy day fund would you like to have in case you needed something for the repair cafe?
Well, $500 would be fantastic.
$500? How much?
$500, just to get it started. Okay. Just an initial stocking.
This is pie in the sky, so there's no reason not to say $500. The volunteer coordinator would obviously be a part-time position. You know, the $2,500 that we had budgeted for the second year is probably the right amount of money to have in there. Event postcards. Susan, do you know how much that postcard cost? Was it like $5,000 or $6,000?
I would say between $4,000 or $5,000.
I would say on the high side. I mean, my memory of that was that there was a grant for $10,000 that paid for that postcard, and I don't know that Karen used all the money for the postcard, but she used a lot of it.
Yeah.
So I would say $5,000.
Is that a once a year thing that we put out with all the events on it?
Well, that happened once.
Yeah.
So I would say that the postcard, I would extend it to not just the postcard, but publicity in general.
Yes.
So you want to have more than 5,000. You really want to have 10,000.
For instance, in thinking about which events might be more appropriate for the DPW to pay versus us, I think our toy exchange is something that really, although the whole city benefits from it, it requires a lot of advertising, and I don't think it's appropriate for all of the advertising to be paid by the DPW, because that's it's kind of a special one for kind of thing that we do that requires extra publicity. So I would add some other advertising costs in there, to the tune of at least $500, probably $1,000, because each ad can be $3 to $500.
So how about if we said $7,500 for the budget? Okay, tipping fees. Mac, what do you think? How much do we need to put in it?
A ton a year.
And that, what is it? How much is a ton?
Let's say $150. That would be two tons, roughly.
Okay. Attending regional conferences. Susan, what does that cost generally?
I don't know. The regional conferences, there are no reuse conferences except for the Reuse Connex, which is in Boston this year in October. I don't know what it costs to attend that. I will find out.
Okay.
The R3 conference coming up on the 29th.
The which?
Get into that for $50.
What is it? The what?
R3, the recycling. What's the official name? It's the R3 conference.
It's the Mass Recycle Conference. It's Reduce, Reuse, Recycle Conference. They have a lot of, they have a composting piece and a recycling reuse piece. Now, one year they had a special reuse track, and I think that they've dropped that. I don't know. We have to look, but they haven't been talking about it. But they often talk about reuse and recycling issues. So it is a very interesting conference to go to, but it's heavily on composting and legislative kind of what's coming down the pipe kind of topics.
Shipping for sending recyclables elsewhere, Mac?
Well, when I looked into Green Disc, it was about $1 a pound, basically.
Maybe $500?
Yeah, let's say that.
Okay. Tools and equipment?
Similar.
$500.
And that's probably more than we use, but.
And this is an annual thing. This is not just for the next year, but annually what we'd need. Volunteer refreshments, $250.
That's $285. Even that is going to be more than enough.
So that's meeting and volunteer refreshments.
Yeah. I mean, there are not that many occasions where it's appropriate.
I have the cost for the conference here.
Reuse Connex?
What is that?
Early bird is $225. Up till May 31st, $250, and it rises till $275 and $300. And at the door, it's $350.
Okay, so we'll put $500 in for conferences.
That's only going to send two people. Is that To that one, although the one, the R3 one is less expensive.
I wasn't assuming we were going to send multiple people, but what, I mean, we can do anything we want.
Well, that would, you know, that would be more of a, not an annual expense. I mean, I see an annual expense as being smaller, but the, as like a one-time opportunity kind of expense. And I think that would fall under a different category almost, because if reuse Connex will never be in our own state in the next, you know, 10 years again.
That's 250 up until May 31st.
Yeah.
Right.
Then it goes up.
But, you know, there are, to Peter's point, there are other conferences besides the one that's going on in Boston. You know, whether it's, I mean, I used to go to DEP meetings. I don't know if that's, I don't know how I got there, but they were certainly useful. And, you know, there's conferences all the time. You just want to have the fund available if it comes up. So, that, so I think, you know, maybe $500 is a good amount of money to put
to
into
start
that.
With.
Yeah. Okay, so we have the makings of a budget. So I'll redo a budget, and we can look at it again. You know, we're really talking about probably about $13,000 as a budget, if we got everything that we wanted. So there you go, that's what we need to raise.
How much?
13,000. 10, 11, 12. Yeah, just under 13. So I think what we should do is give it some thought over the next month. If anything else comes up, you can email me and I can add it to the budget. I'll bring the budget back in the next meeting and we can talk about how we're going to raise that 13,000.
While we're on the topic, because there's no other place that it can fit, I just found out that there is another Northeast Recycling Council webinar that is free. This is similar to, it's part of the series, I believe, that Nat and I had participated in a few months ago.
Mm-hmm.
The topic is Stuck on Reuse, Resources for Making It Work. Learn about the variety of available resources for setting up and implementing different reuse options for rural and urban communities. I want you guys to know about it. I think it would be interesting. I think that some or a lot of what they're taking is based on our model here. So I don't know that there's going to be a whole lot of new information, but I know Athena has worked with other community groups. She worked with a tribe up in Northern New York, who did a toy swap like we did, and some other things. So she has people that she's pulling from the regional area, and it might be interesting. And
when,
it's free. That's the Northeast Recycling Council.
When is it? When's it scheduled for?
I gotta look.
Thank you.
March 24th, Thursday, 1 p.m.
Week
to
from
3
today.
P.m.
To 3-4. 1 to 3.
And if you go on our Facebook page, I'm going to make a special post for it, but
okay.
She put it in the comments of the post I did about the Smith Volk launching the educational adult program, which, by the way, is the most shared and most liked post ever in the history of our Facebook page. I have 6,200 people have seen it, and we have 100 people who have liked it, and 39 people have shared it.
Which is that,
Susan? Precedent.
The Smith Volk proposal for doing
adult
education. And that's on our Facebook page.
It was in the paper, and I posted it onto the Facebook page,
uh-huh.
And it was, I mean, that's by, it's above and beyond any other response we've gotten from any post ever.
Wow.
Okay.
Including repair classes.
Let's move on, unless there's anything else about the re-center.
Susan, do you want to say anything about the roof?
Yes, we have loose roofing came in. So the initial roofer was not interested in working with us because of the prevailing wage requirements. So we have somebody identified who's willing to do the work, and it's just a matter of getting it past the mayor and getting the mayor's approval. So that's
think it's considerably cheaper.
It is considerably cheaper than
I assume it's L-U-C-E.
Yes. Oh, loose. I think you'd want up and tight.
L-U-C-E.
Okay. The whole roof was 3,500 with this new person, it was 7,000.
Right, I think that they were going to do something a little different, but yeah, it is less money.
Which is a bargain.
Okay, event coordinator report. First one is the spelling bee, I believe. Is that right? And who is helping me with that? Mac, are you on that?
And John as well. John was doing the pre-work, and then you guys were going to
Yeah, no, but there was one other volunteer at the last meeting who said,
Diana?
That was Diana, I think, yeah. So, Mac, I'll send you an email and just tell you what time to be there. It's really just a matter of standing next to a garbage can.
Right. Right.
Directing people. We do need signs, compost signs. Evidently, John said they didn't have them at the high school, which is where we got them last year. So, do we have any compost signs?
John borrowed them from me, I think.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Oh, do you?
I have compost signs. Yeah, I have signs.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, no, I have signs, and if I don't have them officially as Northampton, I have them for other events that I do in Amherst and
right.
borrow.
Great. So I guess I got those signs back to you. I left them on your chair last year. That's
okay.
what happened. Yes.
Yep.
So when can I get them from you?
When is the date again?
The 30th. Is that right?
The 30th
yeah.
of March?
Yeah, it's the 30th of March.
Yes, correct.
Which is a Wednesday.
Next week is fine.
Well, I'll be out of the country, but the
okay.
But when I get back?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Should I send you an email to remind you that I'm going to need them?
Yeah, I have yes.
Okay. Excellent. So that's and then basically I take the compost and deposit it.
Which you guys have, do you use bags?
Debbie evidently has bags for me.
Okay.
Thanks for reminding me.
Okay. And what about bins? What kind of bins do they use?
They just use big garbage cans.
Okay.
And then I take the compostable bags at the end of the night.
Okay, because we do have, if you want to make it look, part of my, I think my success in Amherst with some of our public events that we've done, if you can make it look clean and organized and legitimate, you know, with printed nice signs and nice containers, it makes people feel less icky about the whole thing. And we do have those corrugated plastic bins. We have a brown one that says trash, it's printed. We've got a green one that says recycling, or a green one that says compost, and a blue one that says recycling. So if you want to make it look, you know, like this is a real thing, and did you already know about it? We have that opportunity, and Deb has those.
Okay.
You can borrow them from Deb. And they're folding corrugated plastic bins.
Okay, great.
Which take a line.
Which take a line, yes.
Yeah, well, she has the liners also.
Yeah. Well, you won't need a compostable liner for the recycling bin and the trash. You'll need a trash bag.
Right. We're not really dealing with the trash and the recycling, but I'll get some thought about whether I want to take that
It makes
on.
It look more like a disposal
yeah, yeah,
station.
I get it. Okay. The next event is?
Next event is the April 30th reuse and recycling rally, and John is already on top of everything. We will be collecting styrofoam, bikes, not bombs will be there, bulky rigid plastic. We're going to collect pellet bags and
pumpkins.
No, but it's a new twist because of the textile recycling initiative that I think I might have mentioned last month that the DEP is starting around Earth Day. We're going to collect textiles. So the big push is to get people to understand that even if something is worn, torn, or stained, that it still has some recycling value. And the DEP has been working with SMART, which is the Secondary Materials and Recovery and Recyclable Textile Lobbying Organization or Professional Organization. And they, Salvation Army and some of the other major charitable collectors are part of that organization, and they are promoting the concept that we will take anything. They prefer to have wearable clothing, but if it is worn, torn, or stained, they will take it, as long as it is clean and dry. So that's going to be part of our messaging for the spring collection, that we will have a Salvation Army truck there, and we will also be collecting textiles of all kinds. That means stuffed animals, it means sheets, blankets, pillows, worn, torn, stained. It just has to be dry and clean. The dry piece is just because mildew is a major, major problem.
Yeah.
And if one wet thing gets into a bale of clothing, it will ruin the whole bale. So it's really important to get that message out. So we're in good shape for the rally on the
Great.
On the
circuit. What's the one after that?
The one after that is
SOS.
The Garden Pot Exchange, which John is also in charge of, and that takes very little work. We're going to be saving pots that are collected at the April 30th event. And last year, Smith Boat let us store them on site, and we'll just pull them out. And so we have something to start with when the SOS plant sale starts.
They have a ton too. They bring out a pickup truck that's full of pots of tea.
Oh, do they?
Well, they use it for the event.
Oh, I didn't know they did that.
So they just, yeah, they have a ton too.
Okay.
And then people just start bringing them.
Yeah.
And what date is that? What date is it?
That is the 7th. Yeah.
May 7th.
All right, and the next event after that?
Is Hazardous Household Waste, which you guys are not involved in.
Right. And then?
And then it's October. Tag sale. So we've got some time.
Okay. Do you want to talk about the DPW director?
I don't, because I had hoped to get some news, and I did not manage to do that. It's possible that other people in the room might have news, but I don't want to put them on the spot. Does anyone know anything about the DPW search, director search? No? Okay. I don't think anything is known other than the mayor is in the process of reviewing the applicants and starting to do interviews, I imagine.
Okay. Is there new business? I'm purposely skipping over one thing.
Yes, there is new business. At least I have some announcements. Is that okay?
Sure.
I have a press release that is getting reviewed by the mayor's office to go out about our slate of events. You can pass that around if you want. I also updated our schedule of events that's going to be going out. Deb will put it up at transfer stations. It'll go onto Facebook. It'll go into the paper for the Earth Day insert, which I'll talk about in a minute. So I just wanted you to know about that. I also brought a copy of the letter, the final letter that went out to Mayor Narkowitz about our kind of lobbying that whoever's chosen, don't forget us, whoever's chosen to be supportive of our work. I also wanted to share with you, I took some kindergartners from Lander Grinspoon Academy to the landfill, and they gave me a little thank you thing. That's very sweet. So for your awe factor this morning, they were asked, first of all, it's made out of reused material, and they were each asked what their favorite thing for the tour was. And first we went to Locust Street, and I showed them compost, and they got to see how people first come. And then we went to Glendale Road and looked at the landfill. So there's your little awe factor for the morning. What happened to here. David Shearer wanted to be sure that we spent some time talking about this publication, which is one of the things that I'm working on. The deadline for advertising, if anyone is interested in advertising in it, like Berkshire Natural, or anyone else, the advertising deadline and the copy deadline, when we need to get everything into the Gazette, is April 1st. It comes out around April 22nd,
It has been gaining in popularity and exposure as the years go on. It now goes out in the Gazette, the Amherst Bulletin, the Franklin County Reporter. It gets put into newsstand issues of the Shelburne something or other. And it is also distributed widely through DPW's libraries, events throughout Franklin County and our area here. So it's a really great public awareness, public education piece that comes out. Amy Donovan from Franklin County Solid Waste Management District and I put it out. And in the past, the Northampton has always done a hazardous household waste ad so that people know about our hazardous household waste event local. And then for many years, we've taken a full page ad out. This is probably the most prominent site for an ad in the whole publication. It's the back page, and we get first crack at it. It's in a way supporting the entire publishing of the of this insert, because this is not a Gazette funded or a Gazette sponsored insert. It's a MRF advisory board sponsored insert. So if we don't sell advertising for this, it doesn't come out. So not only is it great for the Northampton DPW to have this kind of exposure, but it's also supporting this being put into, you know, the hands of 400,000 people in the Pioneer Valley. So it's a really important thing to support, and I'm assuming and hoping that we will continue to be able to put the two ads in it. The Gazette also gives us a very good rate, because we are the organizers of the insert. And this year, we are looking at doing something similar with having a schedule, our schedule of the events, some information about the recenter, and we also are going to do something similar to what we did 2 years ago, where we talk about the benefits of sticker ownership, permit, transfer station permit ownership. So I just wanted to let you guys know about that. This year the theme is going to be reuse, and we're excited to have, we're excited about that, and we'll be taking pictures, et cetera. I don't know that because of the April 1st deadline, unless I have some great pictures from last year, I don't know that we'll have a recenter picture, but there will definitely be information about the recenter. And I was thinking of maybe using some of Max collective
stories.
The specific thing that we're trying to accomplish is to get the $600 committed, right, by the city.
Right. It's more than 600. Between the two ads, it's more than $600. I think. Yeah. It's more like 900 or something.
This committee could vote on the degree of support we have for
the ongoing support.
The city to not forget about it.
Sure. Yeah, I think we need to. David, do you have a motion?
I move that we support.
The total dollars be $960.
Say $1,000. That we feel that the $1,000 required to place ads in this is a great benefit to not only the DPW for advertising, but for the entire community for getting this awareness out.
It furthers our mission.
And we support the expenditure of that.
Of up to a thousand.
Well, it's more than a thousand.
To put a $1,000 is reasonable and accomplishes what we makes it specific.
So does the proposal include sending a letter of recommendation to the Board of Public
Well, we don't have time to do that.
Yeah, we don't have time for a letter, but
get it in their budget.
To get it on their radar screen. I will.
They is.
The DPW.
The DPW, okay.
Jim and the commission, whoever's, and the mayor, whoever makes those decisions. We've done it before. It's an important piece of public education for North Hampton.
And how are we going to communicate that to the decision makers?
You tell me. Do you want me to mention it when I speak with him? Is that all it needs? Or do you want somebody, one of the commission members, to say this is important?
You can just send an email.
Well, you're the communication channel.
Right.
But I think if you could say that he spent a lot of time discussing the importance of it, voted unanimously to support spending.
Okay.
And who redesigns the ads?
Did we vote? We haven't voted.
Oh, yeah.
We haven't voted. So the proposal is for Susan to take the message that we endorse spending up to $1,000 for advertising in the in this insert for the Gazette, this Earth Day insert. Is that right? Does that sound right?
Yes.
Okay, is there a second for that?
Second.
All right. Any blocking concerns? Any comments? All right, all in favor? All right, looks unanimous.
Great. So also in that vein, I have to ask your forgiveness. I created a letterhead for the reuse committee that I used for the mayor's letter that was going around. And I took it upon myself without asking the committee, and I will never do so again, to put it on top of a letter that I wrote to potential advertisers in this Earth Day insert. And I said at the bottom, this letter is written on Reuse Committee letterhead because the Northampton Reuse Committee is excited about this year's edition and are strong supporters of the reuse and repair of all durable merchandise. You will find the rate sheet from the Gazette attached, blah, 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 blah. So this was essentially just something that would go to advertisers. I've already dropped it off at the Cancer Connection, at Magic Genie, what is the... vintage
place. Retro Genie.
And a couple other places, Costa Shop, encouraging them to advertise in this edition because it's focused on reuse. I thought that having the reuse committee letterhead would make it more appealing as opposed to the City of Northampton letterhead, which still has Ned's name on it, and it just seemed like this was a more powerful sell. So that's why I did it, and I apologize for not getting your permission beforehand. Final announcement is very, very exciting. I got a text from Anna Moore, and she is going to be in town next week on spring break, and she said that because of some posts that were made on our Facebook page, that she had been doing some research into the Discard Studies website, and that's actually an organization, I believe it's a Canadian organization, that's an academic kind of wing of waste reduction and waste issues, and she has decided to major in environmental science with a emphasis in discard studies. And her advisor said that discard studies is a real thing, and she thinks it's a great idea, and I thought you guys would all really enjoy knowing that we have influenced a young, great mind that will go well and far in the world.
That's okay. We skipped over one thing in the agenda, which was to create a plan to revisit the mission. Do we want to talk about that? Do we want to adjourn? Do we want to postpone that till the next meeting? How do people feel? Debbie's leaving. Should we just postpone it till April?
Can you explain what that's about?
Sure.
Maybe we should ask who doesn't know what it's about first.
Better. Who doesn't know what it's about?
I think we all know.
Yeah. We might want to, before the next meeting, just send out, if we have a short description of our mission, just send out. Remind people that we're going to be discussing it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Could that go out on the agenda, Susan?
It can go out with the agenda, yeah.
Great. Excellent. Is there a move to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right.